evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Benjamin Upper School production of All in the Timing, an evening of wacky comedy, intimate encounters, time warps, and a historical figure trying to make sense of his legacy and the world. Our first play, English Made Simple, focuses on two characters, Jack and Jill, as they connect, break apart, and try to reconnect while at a party and under the guidance of the love guru himself, Zach Levine. So without further ado, English Made Simple.
English Made Simple, Chapter 3, The Party, Section 1, Saying Hello.
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 But remember, before you begin, the first 3 minutes of conversation between two people can determine their relationship for the rest of eternity. So watch your language.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
I don't think I know you.
My name's Jill.
I'm Jack.
How do you do?
Friend of the host?
Friend of the hostess.
Oh, so...
Well...
Yeah, nice party.
Nice party. Yeah. Hello, hello, hello. It's always hello.
You're the most wonderful woman at this party.
And then, goodbye, goodbye.
You have the light that surrounds you.
Every time I hear the word hello, it's like a magic incantation. It opens sesame.
Hello, I say to her.
Abracadabra.
My name is Jack.
And I expect a whole new universe to open up in front of me.
Full of joy.
Mm. Hello, hello.
And then, goodbye, goodbye.
Section 2, structure of the English conversation.
Fred.
First name.
Mary.
First name.
Hello.
Hello.
Salutation. Social display of affection followed by...
I didn't know you were here.
Friendly observation answered by...
I'm here.
Statement of the obvious.
How are you?
Superficial question about health.
Good.
Superficial answer. Occupational question.
How's the job?
And.
Terrific.
Acceptable falsehood. Meaningless monosyllable while searching for a new topic.
Quite a smorgasbord.
Attempted a new topic.
Yeah.
Noncommittal noise to reject the topic and.
Well.
Exclamation, to signal the approaching end of the interchange. Well done.
I was in love with you once upon a time.
You asked me about my job and I lied to you.
You, who look so self-possessed and mature.
I would have answered you honestly once upon a time.
But once upon a time, you cried in my arms like a little child.
We would have talked like two people who love each other and then we would have gone home and lay in each other's arms.
We used to go to parties like this all the time.
Together.
So happy. Well...
Nice seeing you, Fred.
Expression of pleasure. First name.
Take care of yourself, Mary.
Parting wish. First name.
Bye.
Valediction. Section 7. Fill in the blank. Or, the arbitrariness of information.
Excuse me, but don't I know you? My name's Jack.
Hello.
Yeah, my name's Bill.
How are you?
My name's Ted.
Ooh, how do you do?
Barney, and you are?
Monica.
Oh, how are you, Monica?
Denise.
Oh, hi, Denise.
Louise.
Oh, how are you, Denise? And wait, Louise, right? Oh, messed that up, sorry. But wait, could we have gone to college together?
I went to Stanford.
Ah, good school.
Bennington.
Oh, party school.
Chicago.
Oh, wait, and sorry, your name is?
Louise, and you are?
Mark.
Oh, so, where did you grow up, Matthew?
Well, I mean...
Jim?
Well,
Stanley!
Well, I grew up in Washington.
Ooh.
St. Louis?
Great place.
Santa Fe, you know what I'm talking about.
Nice.
And wait, Jane, wasn't it?
My name is Jill.
Oh, sorry.
And yet, really? My name could be anything.
Anyway, I went to med school.
I wasn't born with a name.
Went to law school.
I was given a name.
Went to plumbing school, you know Mr. Baser, I know.
My name could just as easily be Beth or Phyllis or Jane.
Quite a smorgasbord, isn't it?
Or Gertrude or Natasha.
Do you know what the problem with the smorgasbord is? There are too many choices.
A hummingbird doesn't have a name.
Do I want chicken or roast beef?
A fish doesn't have a name.
Pate or cheese?
A hedgehog doesn't have a name.
It's just like life that way.
It's just this nameless thing. A handful of skin and fur and a heart beating inside of it.
Should I work? Nah, you know I'm not gonna do that. Should I read? English sucks. Should I listen to music?
Completely anonymous.
Should I go to the movies or should I stay at this party?
With a name, you're just an example of something.
You know what the problem with the smorgasbord is? There are too many choices. I can't choose anything.
A hedgehog doesn't even know it doesn't have a name.
You know, I thought this party could be a total waste.
But, wait, I'm not an example of something.
But I came to this party because I thought I might meet the love of my life.
I'm somebody.
I'm Jack.
I'm Jill.
Section 26, the conditional tense, or should, would, Hood.
Okay, so we meet at this park.
And we like each other.
We like each other instantly. Hello, I'm Zeno.
Miranda, did you know that the first 3 minutes of conversation between two people can determine your relationship to the other person for the rest of eternity?
But we passed the 3 minute mark. We meet, we mesh.
Oi, what a mesh.
And it all begins right here, right on this spot. All things seem possible.
All things are possible.
An infinite smorgasbord lies before us, but what do we do?
Party's wrapping up.
Crowd is thinning.
And the question of the moment is,
should I ask you out?
Should I ask you out?
And if you do,
should I accept?
This could be one of the most glorious and intoxicating moments, best left in memory.
Or it could be the start of eternal love.
So I say, would you like to get a cup of coffee sometime? And you say,
sorry, but thanks anyway.
I've got that so many times. Okay, bye. And that leads to the road of no thank you.
A dead end.
Or while this road down here is,
would you like to get a cup of coffee sometime?
Sure.
And so we go out for coffee.
And we have a horrible time.
Dead end.
Or we have a wonderful time, which means
more coffee.
And it stops right there.
Dead end.
Or, you know, we have a wonderful time and we go out for a third cup and a fourth cup and a fifth cup.
Would we have kissed by now?
Maybe we would have.
I see, we should have.
You know, we could have.
Let's say we did.
And it was horrible to wet new.
Dead end. Or it was wonderful, which means
more coffee and
we move in with each other.
A mistake, no.
Dead end.
Or, you know,
it was wonderful, which means
we get engaged.
Marriage.
Children.
Bliss. And on to divorce.
You know, maybe we, you know, we took that road years and years ago. You know, the road of no thank you. And we take it again. And, you know, I say at a party and you say,
hello, I'm Miranda.
I'm Zeno.
And a whole universe opens up in front of us.
Full of joy.
All things are possible.
An infinite smorgasbord lies before us.
Should, would, could.
Well, it was nice meeting you, Miranda.
Yes, nice meeting you, Zeno.
Section 78, saying goodbye.
Listen, I don't want a few minutes.
Let's practice a typical interchange, please. Okay.
The crowd's wrapping up, the party's thinning, coats are flying off the bed.
Typical interchange, please.
Listen, I just wanted to tell you, you're the most wonderful woman at this party.
Practice a typical interchange, please.
On this street, in this city, in this country, on this planet.
You're the most wonderful man that I've met in years.
You have the light that surrounds you.
You're intoxicated.
You're radiant. I came to this party with one thing, and I leave it transformed.
I came to this party to meet the love of my life.
And you are her.
You are she.
You are her.
My name could be anything.
But it's Jill.
I could have gone anywhere tonight.
But you came to this party.
Hello, hello.
Abracadabra, my name is Jack.
Would you like to get a cup of coffee sometime, Jack?
Sure, I'd like that very much.
And it all starts right here.
A plus.
My lover stands on golden sand. Mere Mortals takes place 50 stories above sea level, where three guys, and I mean guys, construction workers, talk shop, reminisce about home, and always try to outdo one another during their lunch break. So let's just get straight to it. Ladies and gentlemen, Mere Mortals.
And never again.
Unbelievable. I'm the man who broke the bank at Monte Carlo. Hey, Joe.
Hey, Charlie.
Hey, Joe.
Hey, Frank.
So, think we're gonna make 50 today?
It looks like it.
50 stories down, 50 stories to go. Looks like we're gonna have this baby all punched in a week ahead of schedule.
Yeah.
And what a view to lunch by, huh?
Beautiful.
Jersey.
Yeah.
My home.
And that's what I love about working up here. We eat like kings.
So, what's the bill of fare today? Frankie, what do you got?
I think it's liverwurst.
Very nice. Joe, how about you?
Pickled pimento loaf.
Well, I got corned beef and pastrami.
Wait a minute. It's not liverwurst, it's tuna. Charlie, is this liverwurst or is it tuna? You got corned beef and pastrami.
And poupon mustard.
Hey, Joe, did you hear this?
Joe.
Very nice. Very nice.
Thank you.
So what's the occasion, Charlie?
Who says there's an occasion?
All right. Give me a, what's in the news today, Joe? Something hot in the paper?
The news is that history's a cesspool.
Oh, no.
As it always was, we also find out that a woman in Astoria, Queens, lived with a guy for 15 years. Didn't know the guy had five of the wives.
Five of the wives?
In the same neighborhood.
Hey, did you hear this?
Many things are possible in this world.
A guy with that many wives, is that still a bigamy?
It's, geometry.
Huh. Oh, give me the TV, Pidge, would you? Let's see what's on the tube.
No, I don't want to hear nothing about TV.
Hey, I just want to see what I'm missing.
I don't want to hear nothing about TV. We got bowling tonight.
I just want to see.
Speaking of which, who's in for bowling tonight?
Hey, I'm in.
Joe, you win.
I can't this week, Charlie.
What, you gotta nail up some doilies in your wife's powder room or something?
I got some things I gotta do at home.
So do them tomorrow.
Bridget wants me to do them tonight.
So bring her along and do them tomorrow.
I can't do them tomorrow.
Hey, who's the king in your house? Who's the king? Who makes the rules?
When Maggie wanted you to put in that new floor, you wouldn't let us bowl for two weeks, Charlie.
That was different.
And because you couldn't bowl, you wouldn't let us bowl
that
either.
That was different.
Yeah, why was it so different?
Just don't get small on me. Okay, Joe.
Why was it so different?
I hate it when you get small on me like
gentlemen,
that.
Gentlemen, please.
And it's not doilies.
Okay. So, how's your wife doing, Frankie?
Pep Tech, got any of those sugar cubes? Thanks.
I said, Frankie, how's your wife doing?
She's good.
Doctor fixed her all up and everything.
Hey, looks like it. She was out there mowing the grass yesterday.
That's a sign.
Hey, that's a sign. How's that new lawnmower you just bought? How's it working?
It's busted.
No.
Yeah.
Already?
Yeah.
So did you take it back?
I don't know why I ever cut my lawn in the first place. I like it long. I like to sit on my porch and look at it long. Where do you think the word long comes from in the first place? It comes from long, because grass, it's always so long. Originally, people said, I'm gonna plant some seeds and I'm gonna grow a lawn. Then some moron thought he'd be different and cut his lawn short. The rest, it's history of fashion.
I did not know that.
Yeah. You say something, Joe.
Oh, no, I didn't say nothing.
I was ever think about hang gliding home from here.
Hang gliding home?
Yeah, instead of driving or taking the path.
And wouldn't you have to learn how to hang glide first?
Well, sure, you'd learn. But then after you'd learn, you could just strap on some wings, sail off the top floor, and fly home. Be the first person in history to fly from 10th Avenue and 32nd Street to Tenafly, New Jersey, with a fabulous view all the way. Maybe after I retire.
You know, I've been sitting here eating this thing, and I still don't know, is it tuna or is it liverwurst?
Yeah, that's all the ozone up here.
The what?
The carbon dioxide at this altitude. It compresses the things in your nose. You can't taste nothing.
Oh, my God.
You say something, Joe.
Oh, no, I guess the carbon dioxide was compressing my nose or something.
Maybe it was.
Hey, speaking of flying, Charlie, they got that movie about the limbo kid on again tonight.
They got the what?
That movie about the limbo kid. Hey, what the hell are you doing?
I just want to see.
Didn't you see that movie the time it was on with Anthony Hopkins as what's his name?
Bruno Hopkins.
Yeah, didn't that happen someplace around
Hopewell,
here?
Hopewell, New Jersey.
What are they bringing that turkey back for?
Turkey?
Yeah, who wants to see that garbage all over again?
Well, for your information, it happens to be a very thoughtful movie. And, as it happens, today's the anniversary of the day that the Limbug baby got kidnapped.
That happened 50 years ago. What's the big deal about it?
Jesus Christ died on Easter. They show the King of Kings that weekend.
Gentlemen.
And if you'd ever done anything more important than glue your wife's cat pictures into a photo album, they play the Joe Morelli story on your birthday.
Okay.
That's lady why the movie's on tonight.
Charlie, what's with you today? Something the matter?
No, nothing's the matter.
You're acting all weird.
I'm not weird.
So what's up?
Turkey!
What's up? I told you, I don't want to hear the word turkey!
Something sure seems up!
Nothing's up. I'm fine. Nothing's up.
All right. Here, pretty. What the heck is that?
What does it look like? It's a cupcake.
Hey, Joe, will you look at this?
Isn't that nice? Maggie made him a cupcake.
My wife did not make me this cupcake. I bought this cupcake.
What's the, you know...
Celebration.
Celebration, Charlie.
Who says it's a celebration?
Corned beef. And pastrami. And a chocolate cupcake.
For your information, a very somber color. Maybe I'm observing a very solemn holiday for some personal reason.
Hey, next thing you know, he's gonna be putting out doilies around the house. Your taste in movies is lousy. And if you ask me, Charles Lindbergh is overrated.
Overrated?
Yes, so he flew across the ocean.
The greatest hero in American history.
He flew across the ocean. Big deal.
Oh, big deal, huh?
Yeah, and as for the Lindbergh baby, who cares?
Who cares?
Yeah, who the hell cares? It's old news.
Old news?
It's ancient history. That kid got stolen.
Oh, come on. Well, for your information.
Working people get kidnapped in the real world every day. They don't go make movies about
Maybe
them.
They're not as important as the Lindbergh baby.
So why am I supposed to care about the Lindbergh baby?
You don't care about the Lindbergh baby.
No, I don't care about the Lindbergh baby.
You don't have any feelings for the Lindbergh baby.
No, I don't have any feelings for the Lindbergh baby.
Well, for your information, I am the Lindbergh baby.
You're the...
Yeah, I'm the Lindbergh baby, stolen from the rightful home of my parents, Charles Lindbergh. And I didn't mean to tell you, but you forced me into it. And the hell if I'll sit here and listen to my family being insulted too, so there.
You're the...
Yeah.
But your name is Petrosian.
Oh, sure. That's what I was brought up to think my name was.
You think you're the Lindbergh baby?
Shut up, Joe.
Have you gone off your head?
No, I have not gone off my head.
I don't believe this.
Yeah, well, the truth is always strange at first sight, so live with it.
Do you know? There are separate asylums to hold everyone who think they're the Lindbergh baby.
Go ahead. Scoff if you will.
Charlie, there are people who might wonder a little bit if you claim to be the limbo
king. But it all fits, don't it? I mean, Charlie, was I not born in New Jersey and brought up in the town of Hopewell where the crime was perpetrated?
He was brought up in the town of Hopewell, Joe.
Yeah, that makes about 50,000 other Lindbergh babies.
Well, they're imposters.
I thought the police found that kid's body.
That was another kid's body.
Whose body?
I don't know whose body. It wasn't my body.
Obviously not. So why did you keep this a secret from all these years, Charlie?
Well, naturally. A lot of people wouldn't believe me.
Oh, really?
Plus, I was already pretty well established as Charles Petrosian. You know, bank statements, credit cards, driver's licenses.
Sure, it's hard to make a change.
But most of all, I didn't want to upset the feelings of my true mother, Anne Morrow Lindbergh.
Whose books are bold.
Hey, shut your trap about my mother.
Joe, you know better than that.
Have you read her books?
Yes, I have, and I think they're very thoughtful.
She made a fortune off of you writing about that kidnapping.
It happened to be a very traumatic experience for her.
That don't mean she gotta go pedal on the street corner. I mean, you gotta ask for a cut of her royalties, you could retire early and take up hang gliding.
You know, Charlie, Joe's got a good point. You should contact the family. You could be a really rich guy,
Actually, I did write to Mother once.
You wrote to her?
Yeah, but I never got a reply. Figured the letter never got to her.
Oh, sure. Dear Mom, guess who? And then you signed it. Your loving son, Charles Petrosian. P.S. Send the inheritance.
I hinted at who I was. I told her I was from her area. That's how I put it. I was from her area.
That's a hint.
Sigmund Freud would have had a picnic.
I told her I'd seen the house I got kidnapped from lots of times.
You saw the house you were kidnapped from?
Oh, sure. I used to go by there all the time as a kid. And then when I got older, I used to park in front of this tree. I used to sit there looking at the house thinking, this is yours, Charlie. This is your kingdom.
So your old man flew across the Atlantic in the Spirit of St. Louis.
And my grandfather was ambassador to Mexico.
I did not know that.
Yeah, my mother's father.
I saw that movie lots of times in the Late Show. It must have been great having Jimmy Stewart play your father and all.
I wrote to Jimmy too once, under my nom de plume, Charles Petrosian.
Did he ever answer back?
Got a signed autograph in the mail.
You never told me that.
Yeah.
You never told me you had a signed picture of Jimmy Stewart.
I've been keeping it a secret all these years in case people start getting ideas about my true identity. You know, people start putting a few clues together, it could have repercussions.
Yeah, they'd throw you in the loony bin.
Shut up, Joe.
You know, it's funny you should be saying all this.
What, that I've been the Lindbergh baby all these years and you never even knew it?
Yeah, because you see, I'm the son of Tsar Nicholas II of Russia.
No.
Yeah.
No way.
That's me.
The kid who got killed in the Russian Revolution.
Heir to the throne of Moscow.
Holy sh...
And the sovereign of Ukraine.
But I thought you got shot.
A faithful servant smuggled me out. Nobody knows I survived.
And you had Sir Laurence Olivier in your movie and everything? I mean, Anthony Hopkins is one thing, but Sir Laurence Olivier.
Yeah, I felt pretty honored having him in a movie. But you know, they did have a few quibbles about the historical details.
So, what's your real name?
Alexei Nikolaevich Romanov.
By what name would you prefer to be called?
Just keep calling me Frank. It will be easier.
Besides protecting your incognito.
The Tsar of Russia?
Now, Joe.
The Tsar of Russia?
Be quiet, Joe.
Do you know how old you'd have to be the Tsar of Russia?
Never you mind, Frank.
You'd have to be like 90 years old. And the hemophilia.
Hey, I always was a heavy bleeder.
That don't make you the damn Tsar of Russia. I mean, the Lindbergh baby is one.
Will you shut up? Please just shut up, Joe. Come on. You're on a lot of sensitive ground here. You're talking about families. And Frank here, he lost everybody in the revolution. So have a little sympathy, will you? You've got orphans here.
Okay then, Alexei. How do you know all this? How do you know you're the head honcho of the Ukraine?
Well, one day I was looking at a picture in a book of Moscow and the Kremlin and those domes.
Yeah, those onion-shaped domes.
And I thought to myself, I've been here. It's like I knew it.
Of course you'd remember it. Those communist bastards tried to rub you out of there.
And then, when I saw the movie, it's like before they even turned the corner, I knew it was gonna happen.
Must have been painful.
Yeah, it was pretty painful.
Seeing everything you missed out on.
Yeah, but it only got really painful when I had to watch myself get killed.
Oh my God. Understandably, Alexei. Understandably. So, how's your Russian these days?
I forgot most of it by now.
Yeah, the whole trauma probably made you, you know.
Repress it!
Repress it! Plus the strain of having to maintain your daily identity as Frank Mercola. So, have you told Phyllis?
Nah, I'm just waiting for the right, you know.
Circumstances?
Circumstances.
I think she'd be pretty surprised to find out she's been the queen of Russia
all these years.
Tsarina. Huh?
The wife of the Tsar is the Tsarina.
See, Joe? I say queen. He says Tsarina. He's got the facts at the tips of his fingers.
I know how cars work, but that don't make me a frickin' Oldsmobile.
Just think, Frank. We'd have had you up there all these
yes, the Bowling Wall would have gotten taken down a lot sooner than it did after not being built in the first place.
Yeah, that's the hardest part about being, you know.
Who you are?
Who I am. What I could have done for world peace.
Have you ever contemplated the restoration of your throne?
No, you know, I think I should leave it to the will of the people.
Well, if things had worked out differently, I can't think of anybody I'd rather have on the throne than you, Frank.
Thanks, Charlie. So, Joe.
Yeah, what?
Who are you?
I'm nobody.
I mean, really.
I'm nobody.
I mean, really.
I'm Joe Morelli, period.
Underneath it all.
I'm freaking Superman.
I'm not talking about that.
I'm nobody. I'm just another guy on the street. But in a previous lifetime, I was Marie Antoinette.
No.
Yeah, that was me.
You're kidding.
The Let Them Eat Cake lady?
Yep, said that in 1793. Let them eat cake.
Isn't that something?
Hey, I knew you were somebody.
Yeah, one minute I'm standing on a scaffold in a dime tiara, the next, Joe Morelli and Weehawken.
Oh my gosh, it must have been pretty disconcerting.
To say the least. I mean, I do remember kneeling down on the thing there, the guillotine and the blade.
Yeah. Man.
Already?
Yeah.
O'clock?
That's what the company says.
Jesus. But listen, you guys, you can't tell anybody. Of course not. I don't want the skin around.
We'll be as the tomb.
You swear?
Of course we swear.
We're all in the same, you know.
Situation.
Situation.
Situation. So, first things first, who's in for bowling tonight?
Hey, I'm in.
Joe, you in?
I told you I can't this week, Charlie.
Are you forgetting who you are?
Yeah, remember, the crown jewels.
You're right, come in.
Great.
And c'est la guerre.
Yes.
Charlie, we'll completely understand, though, if you want to stay home and watch the Lempo movie on again.
I've seen it. Let's bowl.
All right.
As long as I'm home by midnight.
Who are you, Cinderella?
Oh, my God.
I'm the man who broke the bank of Monte Carlo.
Somewhere beyond the sea.
Welcome back. Please find your seats so we can visit the famous, or should I say infamous, Leon Trotsky and his wife, Mrs. Trotsky, as they try to understand what really happened to Trotsky while in exile in Coyoacan, Mexico. What happens next is a little play about historical inaccuracy, with lots of physical comedy, many deaths, a Mexican gardener named Ramon, and a pickaxe. Enjoy.
The proletariat is right. The proletariat must always be right. And the revolution of the proletariat against oppression must go on forever.
Leon.
And forever. And forever.
Leon, I was just reading the encyclopedia.
The heading?
Trotsky Leon.
Good. It's about me.
Listen to this. On August 20th, 1940, a Spanish communist named Ramon Mercader smashed a mountain climber's axe into Trotsky's skull in his house in Coyoacan, a suburb of Mexico City. Trotsky died the next day.
What's the date on that encyclopedia?
2012.
Strange.
Yes.
But interesting. I am Trotsky.
Yes.
And this is our house in Coyoacan.
Yes.
And we have a Spanish gardener named Ramon.
Mercader, yes.
And there aren't any other Trotskys living in Coyoacan, are there?
I don't think so. Not under that name.
What's the date today?
August 21st.
Then I'm safe. The article says it happened on the 20th, which means it would have happened yesterday.
Leon.
And I'd be sitting here dead today with a mountain climber's axe buried in my skull.
But Leon.
Will the Capitalist Press never get things right?
Leon, isn't there a mountain climber's axe in your skull right now?
Well, it certainly does look like one, and... You know, Ramon was in here yesterday telling me about his mountain climbing trip, and he brought in his mountain climbing axe to show me, and now that I think of it, I don't know if he had it when he left the room. Did Ramon report to work today? No one is safe. Force must be used, and the revolution of the proletariat against oppression must go on forever and forever and forever.
Leon! was just reading the encyclopedia.
Is it the Britannica?
Listen to this.
The universe is viewed by the victors.
And are you guests? 1940, a Spanish communist named Ramon Mercader smashed a mountain climber's axe into Trotsky's skull in his house in Coyoacan, a suburb of Mexico City. Trotsky died the next day.
Yes, and?
And I think that there's a mountain climber's axe in your own skull right now.
I knew that. This morning when I was shaving, I noticed a handle sticking out of the back of my head. For a moment, I thought it was an ice pick, so at first I was worried.
No, it's not an ice pick.
Don't even say the word. You know my recurring nightmare.
Yes, dear.
But the mountain climber's axe that buries itself in my skull.
Yes, dear.
That's why I've forbidden any of the servants to swallow ice picks into the house.
But, Leon...
No one may be seen in this house with an ice pick, especially not Spanish communists.
But, Leon...
We'll do without ice. We'll drink our liquor neat and our Coca-Cola warm. Who cares if this is Coyoacan in August? Coyoacan in August. Not a bad song title, that. Coyoacan... August... Or, we'll have ice, but we just won't pick at it. Ice will be allowed in the house and blocked, but we'll be picked or chipped out under any circumstances. At least not with ice picks. Ice cube trays will be allowed, if they've been invented yet. That book doesn't say anything about an ice cube tray in my skull, does it?
No.
Does it?
No!
Ha! About smarted destiny. Just only a capitalist explanation for the status quo.
But, Leon!
Also, look at this. Do you know what this is?
No.
It's a skull.
Well, I knew that, but...
I bought this skull. I own this skull. So what does that make this?
Trotsky's skull.
So, if some Spanish communist posing as a gardener wanted to bury anything in my head, be the you-know-what, or anything else, this will be here as a decoy. They'll come in here, we'll see the skull, recognize it as my skull, bury something in it, he'll go his way, and I'll go mine. Isn't it ingenious?
Well, up to a point, but...
50 more years of Trotsky.
I have some very bad news for you.
Mountain climber's axe. Ingenious. Funny. I always thought it was a nice pick.
A mountain climber's axe! A mountain climber's axe! Can't I get that through your skull?
This is very bad news. This is serious.
What's serious, Leon?
I have a mountain climber's axe buried in my skull.
Smashed, actually. The encyclopedia says my hand is smashed.
Yeah, all right. But what am I going to do?
Maybe a hat would cover the handle. You know, one of those cute little alpine hats with the point and the feather.
The encyclopedia says I died today?
The 21st. That's today.
Does it say what time?
Nope.
So much for usefulness of that encyclopedia. Well, I have until midnight at the latest.
What should I tell cook about supper?
Well, she can forget about the soup course.
Trotsky? Ian? Not yet, not!
This man was a gardener.
Yes.
Well, at least he's been posing as a gardener.
Yes.
So, wouldn't that make him a member of the proletariat?
I'd say so.
Then what's he doing smashing a mountain climber's axe into my skull?
I don't know. Have you been oppressing him?
Why would Ramon have done this to me?
Maybe he's a literalist.
A what?
A literalist. Maybe Ramon ran into Manuel yesterday. You know Manuel, the head gardener?
I know who Manuel is.
I know you know who Manuel is.
One of these days, Mrs. Trotsky, bang, zoom.
Maybe Ramon asked Manuel, will Mr. Trotsky have time to look at the natatoriums today? And maybe Manuel said, I don't know, ask Mr. Trotsky.
Very funny.
Or maybe he was just hot to Trotsky.
Very, very funny.
Or maybe he just wanted to pick your brain.
Stop it. Call Ramon in here.
Ramon?
Better get him quickly. I have a mountain climber's axe in my skull.
Ramon, come quickly.
Good morning, Ramon.
Good morning, senor. See, we have very good employer-employee relations here. Ramon, did you bury this mountain climber's axe into my skull?
I did not bury it, senor. I smashed it into your skull.
Excuse me?
You see? You can still see the handle.
It's Julian. The handle is not entirely out of sight.
So we cannot say buried. We can only say smashed, or perhaps jumped.
Yeah, you know what? All right, but why did you do this?
I think I read about an encyclopedia once.
Oh, the power of the printed word.
I wanted to use an ice pick originally, but there were none around the house.
Why, Ramon? Why did you do this? Do you realize who I am? Do you realize that you smashed a mountain climber's axe into the skull of a major historical figure? I helped run the Russian Revolution. I fought Stalin. I was a major political theorist. Was it political disaffection? Anti-counter-revolutionary backlash?
Actually, it was love, senor.
It's Julian. I only didn't want you to find out about it.
No.
This way.
No.
Yes.
No!
See!
Oh God, what a fool I've been! But why did you really do this, Ramon?
You will never know, Senor Trotsky!
This is a nightmare!
Luckily for you, your night will soon be over!
Thank you, Ramon. You may go.
Oh, Senor Trotsky?
Yes, Ramon?
Will you have time to look in the studios today? They are really very beautiful.
I don't think so, Ramon. But I'll try.
Thank you, senor. Hasta la vista. Or should I say, buenas noches.
Well, all right then. August 21st, 1940, the day I'm going to die. And to think, I've gone over so many August 21st in my life, like a man walking over his own grave.
It's been wonderful being married, Julian.
Thank you, Mrs. Trotsky.
Although it was a burden at times, being married to a major historical figure.
I'm sorry I was away from home so often, tending the revolution.
I understand.
Sorry I couldn't have better shown my feelings.
No, please.
I'm sorry I couldn't have better expressed my emotions.
Oh, I haven't been everything I should have been.
Well, it's a little late for regrets now. The mountain climber's axe buried in one skull.
Smashed, actually.
So it wasn't old age or cancer or even the ice pick I feared for years. It was a mountain climber's axe wielded by a Spanish communist posing as a gardener.
You really couldn't have seen that coming.
So, even an assassin can make the flowers grow. The gardener was a false, yet the garden he tended was real. How was I to know, when I passed him every day, he was to be my killer? How was I to know the men tending the nasturtiums was to keep me from seeing what the weather would be like tomorrow? How was I to know I'd never get to see Casablanca, which wouldn't be made until 1942, and which I would have despised anyway? How was I to know I'd never get to know about the bomb or the 80,000 dead at Hiroshima? How was I to know I'd never get to know about Miley Cyrus or Gorbachev or the State of Israel? How was I to know I'd get erased from the history books of my own homeland?
But reinstated partially someday.
There's a time in someone's life when they're in a room and it's the room they never leave. Or you leave a room and it's the last room you ever leave. This is my room.
But you're not even here.
But the desk, the books, the chair.
You're not even here, my love.
The sunlight coming through the blinds.
That was yesterday. You're in a hospital, unconscious.
But you standing there in front of the garden.
That was yesterday, my love.
What does the article say? Read it one more time.
On August 20th, 1940, a Spanish communist named Ramon Mercader smashed the mountain climber's axe into Trotsky's skull in his home in Coyoacan, a suburb of Mexico City. Trotsky died the next day.
Gives a little hope about the world, doesn't it? And a man can have a mountain climber's axe smashed into his skull, then yet live on for a full day.
think I'll go look at the Nasturtiums.
Our next play, The Philadelphia, is an upside-down world where if you say something, it means the exact opposite. The action takes place in a city diner where Al is dining and his friend Mark comes running in with some big news. All the while, there's a waitress who doesn't seem to care either way.
Hey!
Can I help you, sir?
You know you would look fantastic on a wide screen?
Uh-huh.
70 millimeters.
Look, do you want to see a menu or what?
Let's negotiate here. What's the soup du jour today?
Soup of the day. You got a choice of Polish duck blood or cream of kidney.
Beautiful, beautiful. Kick me in the kidney.
You got it.
Any oyster crackers on your sea bed?
Nope, all out.
How about the specials today? Sprayer options.
You got your deep fried gizzard.
Fabulous.
Cow springs with okra.
Your temptress.
And pickled pig's feet.
Pig's feet, I love it. Put me down for a quadruped.
If you say so.
Any sprouts on those feet?
Iceberg.
So be it.
Marcus, what's up?
Jesus!
What's the matter?
Oh, man!
What's going on, buddy?
I don't get it, Al. I don't understand it.
You want something? You want a drink? Go call the waitress.
No, don't even try. I don't know what's going on today, Al. It's really weird.
What?
Right from the time I got up.
What is it, though? What's the story?
Well, just for an example, I stop off at the drugstore there to get some aspirin. This is a big drugstore, right?
Yeah.
So I go up to the counter. The guy says, what can I do for you? I say, give me a bottle of aspirin. He gives me this funny look and he says, oh, we don't carry that, sir. I say to him, you're a drugstore and you don't have any aspirin?
Did they have Buffering?
Yeah.
Advil?
Yeah.
Extra strength Tylenol?
Yeah.
But no aspirin?
No.
Wow.
And that's the kind of weird thing that's been happening all day. It's like I go to the newsstand and buy the Daily News. The guy never even heard of it.
Could have been a misunderstanding.
Nobody had the news. I had to read the Toronto hairdresser. Or get this, I go to a deli at lunchtime to buy a sandwich. They don't have any pastrami. How can they be in a deli if they don't have any pastrami?
Was this a Korean deli?
This was a kosher from Jerusalem deli. Oh, we don't have that, sir, he says to me. Have some tongue. I just got into a cab. The guy says he has to go to 56th Street.
Mom, settle
down. Y'all have to take me to work instead.
Mom, settle down.
Look at me like I'm an alien or something. You know what this is?
Sure.
What is it? What's happening to me?
Don't panic. You're in Philadelphia.
I'm in a what?
You're in Philadelphia, that's all.
But I'm in...
Yeah, physically you're in New York. But metaphysically you're in Philadelphia.
I've never heard of this.
You see, in what we know as reality, there are these pockets, these black holes called Philadelphias. And when you fall into one, you run up against exactly the kind of stuff that's been happening to you all day.
Why?
Because in Philadelphia, no matter what you ask for, you can't get it. You ask for something, it ain't gonna get done. You wanna go somewhere, you can't get there from here.
Good God, this is very serious.
Just remember, Marcus, this is a condition named after the city that named after the cheesesteak. Something that nobody in their right mind would willingly ask for.
I thought I was just having a bad day.
Sure, millions of people have spent entire lifetimes in Philadelphia and never even knew it. Look at the city of Philadelphia itself. Hopelessly trapped inside of Philadelphia, and do they even know it?
So what do I do? Should I just kill myself now and get it over with?
You try to kill yourself in Philadelphia, you're only gonna get hurt, babe.
So what do I do?
You want my advice? Best thing to do is wait it out, and someday the great cosmic train will whisk you out of the city of brotherly love and off to someplace happy there.
You're pretty goddamn mellow today.
Yeah, liberty has to be someplace.
Is your name Alan Chase?
Yeah.
There was a call for you. Your boss?
Okay.
He says you're fired.
Cool, thanks. So anyway, you have this problem.
Did she just say you got fired?
Yeah, what happened to my pig's feet?
But Al, you loved your job.
Hey, no sweat.
How can you be so calm?
Easy. You woke up in Philadelphia, I woke up in Los Angeles, and life was beautiful. You know Susie packed up and left me this morning.
Susie left you?
And frankly, Scarlett, I don't give a damn. I say, go and God bless and may a dating pool be Olympic size.
But Al, the garbage issue goes your life.
So throw it into a movie script, sell it to Paramount, toss in some sex, add a little emotion, blah, blah, blah. You got a buddy movie with the garment background. Not relevant enough? We'll throw a hole in the ozone, make it EC.
EC?
Environmentally correct. Have you heard about the hole in the ozone?
Sure.
Sure, some people are gonna get hurt in the process. In the meantime, everybody else will tan a little faster.
So this is Los Angeles?
Yeah, well, everybody has to be someplace.
Wow.
You want my advice? Enjoy Philadelphia. Order yourself a bean and bucket, and chill out for a while.
But I can't order anything. Life is great out there for you on that cosmic beach. Whatever I ask for, I'll get like a cheesesteak or something.
Marcus, Marcus! There's a very simple rule of thumb in Philadelphia. Ask for the opposite.
What?
If you can't get what you ask for, ask for the opposite and you'll get what you want. You want the Daily News? Ask for the Times. You want pastrami? Ask for tongue.
Oh.
Yeah, it works great with women. What's more opposite than the opposite sex?
Uh-huh.
Okay, Mark, so do you want a bud?
Yeah, extra sure.
No, stop! Do you want a bud?
No, I don't want a bun.
Good. Now there's the waitress. Order yourself a bean and burger. But don't ask for a bean and burger.
Waitress!
Don't call her, she won't come. You're in Philadelphia. So just think. Forget.
Hey, forget her.
You don't need that waitress.
Forget that waitress.
It's anything to do with her.
Hey, waitress, forget you!
Can I help you, sir?
That's why you order in Philadelphia.
Can I help you, sir?
No, thanks.
What do you want?
Well, how about some OJ?
Scooter's broken.
Got some milk?
Cow's dry.
Eggnog?
All out.
Cup of coffee?
We don't have that, sir.
Got any ale?
Nope.
Stout?
Nope.
Porter?
Just beer.
That's too bad. How about Heineken?
Try again.
Rolling Rock?
Out of stock.
Schlitz?
Nix.
Beck's?
Next.
Sapporo?
Tomorrow.
Lone Star?
Hardy Hard.
Bud Light?
Just plain Bud's all we got.
No, thanks.
Give me a Bud! Anything to eat?
No.
Name it.
Pork chops.
Hamburger.
Medium.
Well done.
Baked potatoes.
French fries.
And some zucchini.
Give me a slice of raw, burn one.
Marcus, that was excellent. You sure you've never done this before?
Thank you. I guess I spent so much of my life asking for all the wrong thing. Do it on purpose, comes easy.
I
could have saved myself a lot of trouble all these years if I had screwed up on accident. Could have saved myself a lot of trouble.
You know, now that I think about it, you might have been in Baltimore. They're practically the same thing.
Here's your bud. And one cheesesteak.
Hey, wait a minute, what is this?
It's cheesesteak.
No, I ordered a cream of kidney and 2 pairs of feet.
We don't have that, sir.
I beg your pardon?
We don't have that, sir.
You son of a gun, I'm in your Philadelphia!
I'm sorry, huh?
You brought me into your damn Philadelphia!
I didn't know it was contagious!
Oh, God, please don't let me be in a Philadelphia! Please don't let me be in a...
Hey, should you ask for the opposite? I mean, since you're in a Philadelphia...
Don't you tell me to act in a Philadelphia!
But maybe you're not really
in Philadelphia! I told you everything you know about Philly! Don't tell me to act in a Philadelphia!
But maybe you're not really in a Philadelphia!
Do you see the cheese on this cheesesteak? What do I need for proof? The damn Liberty Bell? Waitress, bring me a glass of water.
Water, we don't have that, sir.
You don't have water? What are we, in a sudden drought or something? Oh, God, I lost my job. Susie left me. Waitress, where's the payphone?
We don't have a payphone.
You don't have a payphone? Of course you don't. Of course you don't.
Guess it's not that bad being in Philadelphia.
Could be worse. I've been to Cleveland all week.
Really? What's that like?
It's like death without the advantages.
You understand?
Sure.
Hope you won't reveal your name.
Sharon.
Goodbye.
Hello.
Want to start?
Thanks.
Yep, everybody has to be someplace. So.
Our last play of the evening takes place in a cafe somewhere in a big city, where two strangers try and try again to connect through many variations and attempts until they know it's a sure thing.
Excuse me? Is this chair taken?
Excuse me?
Is this taken?
Yes, it is.
Oh, sorry.
Sure thing.
Excuse me. Is this chair taken?
Excuse me?
Is this taken?
No, but I'm expecting somebody in a minute.
Oh, thanks anyway.
Sure thing.
Excuse me. Is this chair taken?
No, but I'm expecting somebody very shortly.
Would you mind if I sit here till he, she, or it comes?
Well, they do seem to be pretty late.
You never know, he might be turned down.
Sorry, nice try though.
Sure thing. Is this chair taken?
No, it's not.
Would you mind if I sit?
Yes, I would.
Oh. Is this chair taken?
No, it's not.
Would you mind if I sit here?
No, go ahead.
Thanks. Every place else near seems to be taken.
Mm-hmm.
Great place.
Mm-hmm.
What's the book?
Look, I just wanted to read and find, if you don't mind.
Oh. No. Sorry. Every place else seems to be taken.
Mm-hmm.
Great place for reading.
Yes, I like it.
What's the book?
The Sound and the Fury.
Oh, Hemingway. What's the book?
The Sound and the Fury.
Oh, Faulkner.
Have you read it?
Not actually. I've sure read about it, though. It's supposed to be great.
It is great.
I hear it's great. What's the book?
The Sound and the Fury.
Oh, Faulkner.
Have you read it?
I'm a Mets fan myself.
Have you read it?
Yeah, I ran college.
Where was college?
Well, I don't want to brag or anything, but I attended the prestigious University of Oral Roberts University.
Where was college?
I was lying. I never went to college. I was like, the party!
Where was college?
Harvard.
Oh, do you like Faulkner?
I love Faulkner. I spent a whole winter reading him once.
I've just started.
I was so excited reading 10 pages that I went and bought everything else he wrote. I mean, it was one of the greatest reading experiences of my life. I mean, all that incredible psychological understanding, page after page of gorgeous prose. The way he's grasped the profound mystery of time and human existence, the smells of the earth. What do you think?
I think it's pretty boring.
Oh. What's fun?
The Sound and the Fury.
Oh, Faulkner.
Have you read it? Do you like Faulkner?
I love Faulkner.
He's incredible.
I spent a whole winter reading him once.
I was so excited after the first 10 pages that I went out and bought everything else he wrote.
I mean, all that incredible psychological understanding.
And the prose is so gorgeous.
And the way he's grasped the mystery of time.
In human existence, I can't believe I've waited this long to read him.
You never know. You might not have liked him before.
That's true.
You might not have been ready for him. Had to hit these things at the right moment, or it's some good.
That's happened to me.
It's all in the timing. My name's Bill, by the way.
I'm Betty.
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, so I thought reading Faulkner was a great experience.
Mm-hmm.
The Sound and the Fury.
Well, onwards and upwards.
Waiter! You have to hit these things at the right moment, or it's no good.
That's happened to me.
It's all in the timing. My name's Bill, by the way.
I'm Betty.
Hi.
Hi.
Do you come in here often?
Actually, I'm just in town for 2 days from Pakistan.
Oh. Pakistan. My name's Bill, by the way.
I'm Betty.
Hi.
Hi.
So, do you come in here often?
Every once in a while, do you?
Well, not, you know, so much anymore. I mean, not as much as I used to. You know, ever since, you know, my nervous breakdown. So, do you come in here often?
Why are you asking?
I'm just interested.
Are you really interested, or are you just trying to pick me up?
No, I'm really just interested.
Why would you be interested in whether I come in here a lot?
I'm just, you know, getting acquainted.
Maybe. You're only interested for the sake of making small talk long enough to ask me back to your place to listen to some music, or because you've rented Game of Thrones on Netflix, or because you have some terrific unknown arcade fire record, after which you'll go into the bathroom and pee very loudly, and then pack to the kitchen and get yourself a beer from the refrigerator without asking me whether I'd like anything, and then you'll proceed to lie back down beside me and tell me you've got a girlfriend named Stephanie, who's away at medical school in Belgium for a year, and that you've been with her off and on in what you'll call a very intricate relationship for the past 7 years! None of which interests me, mister.
Okay. So, do you come in here often?
Every other day, I think.
I mean, I come in here often, and I don't remember seeing you.
Guess we must be on different schedules.
Eh, misconnections.
Yes, different time zones.
Maybe I get right next door to somebody's town and never even know it.
I know.
City life.
It's crazy.
You know, we probably pass down the street every day. Right in front of this place, probably.
Yep.
Well, the waiters here should be on different time zones. Can't seem to locate one anywhere. Waiter! So what do you...
I beg your pardon?
Oh, nothing. Sorry.
I guess you must be on different schedules.
Misconnections.
Yes, different time zones.
Maybe I get right next door to somebody's town and never even know it.
I know.
City life.
It's crazy.
Wait. You weren't waiting for somebody when I came in, were you?
Actually, I was.
Oh. Boyfriend?
Sort of.
What's a sort of boyfriend?
My husband.
Aha. You weren't waiting for somebody when I came in, were you?
Actually, I was.
Oh. Boyfriend?
Sort of.
What's a sort of boyfriend?
We were meeting here to break up.
What's a sort of boyfriend?
My lover. Here she comes right now.
So you weren't waiting for somebody when I came in, were you?
No, just reading.
Sort of sad occupation for a Friday night, isn't it? I mean, being here all by yourself?
Do you think so?
Sure. I mean, what's a good-looking woman like you doing out alone on Friday night?
Trying to keep away from minds like that.
No, wait, listen. You weren't waiting for somebody like Ben, were you?
No, just reading.
I mean, sort of sad occupation for a Friday night, isn't it? Reading here, all by yourself?
I guess it is in a way.
I mean, what's a girl like you doing out alone on Friday night? I mean, no offense, but...
I'm out alone on a Friday night for the first time in a very long time.
Oh.
You see, I just recently ended a relationship.
Oh.
A rather long-standing.
I'm sorry. Well, How about this? Since reading by yourself here is such a sad occupation for a Friday night, why don't we go someplace elsewhere?
No.
You want to do something else?
No, thanks.
I was headed to the movies.
I don't think so.
I mean, big chance to let Faulkner catch his breath. All those long sentences, getting pretty tired.
Sorry, nice try though.
Okay.
I appreciate the invitation.
Sure thing. You weren't waiting for somebody who might come in, were you?
No, just reading.
Sort of sad occupation for Friday, isn't it? Reading here all by yourself?
I guess I was trying to think of it as existentially romantic, you know? Great literature, great cappuccino, rainy night.
My work's in Paris. But you know, we could hop on a late flight to Paris. You know, get on a Concorde, find a cafe.
I'm a little short on plane fare tonight.
Darn it, so am I.
Well, listen, I was headed to the movies after I finished this section. Would you like it to come along since you can't locate a waiter?
That's a very nice offer, but...
Uh-huh, girlfriend?
Two of them, actually. One of them's pregnant, and then there's Stephanie.
Girlfriend?
No, I don't have a girlfriend. Not if you mean the castrating!
Girlfriend?
Sort of.
What's a sort of girlfriend?
My mother. I send a relationship, actually.
Oh.
My brother, long-standing.
I'm sorry to hear it.
This is my first night all alone in a long time. I feel a bit at sea, to tell you the truth.
So you didn't stop to talk because you're a Mooney or you have some weird political affiliation?
No. Come on, guys. I'm a straight-down secret Republican. Any Democrats in the house? You want to talk about politics? I like to consider myself a citizen of the universe. I'm unaffiliated.
That's relief, so am I.
I vote my beliefs.
Labels are not important.
Labels are not important. Exactly. I mean, take me, for example. So what if I got a 2-point app? 3-point app? 4-point at college. And so what if I did come from Cleveland, Pittsburgh, Westchester County?
Sure.
I believe a man is what he is. A person is what he is. A person is what they are.
I think so too.
I mean, so what if I'm Mark Trotsky? So what if I spent a whole year in the Peace Corps? I was acting my convictions.
I think so too.
You cannot hang a sign on a person.
Absolutely, I'll bet you're a Scorpio. Well, listen, I was headed to the movies after I finished this section. Would you like to come along?
Oh, sounds like fun. What's playing?
A couple of really early Woody Allen films.
Oh.
You don't like Woody Allen?
No, sure. I like Woody Allen.
But you're not crazy about Woody Allen.
Those early ones kind of get on my nerves.
Uh-huh.
So you know what's like the... Oh, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was gonna say I was headed to the movies in the line.
So was I.
The Woody Allen Festival?
Just up the street.
Do you like the early ones?
I think anybody who doesn't ought to be run off the planet.
How many times have you seen Bananas?
8 times.
I've seen 12. Are you still interested in going?
Do you like Entenmann's crumb cake?
I went out 2 in the morning last night to get one. Did you have an Etch-A-Sketch as a child?
Yes, and do you like Brussels sprouts?
No, I think they're disgusting.
They are disgusting.
And do you still believe in marriage despite the current sentiments against it?
Yes.
And children?
3 of them.
2 girls and a boy?
Harvard, Vassar, and Brown.
And will you love me?
Yes.
Will you cherish me forever?
Yes.
You still love those movies?
Sure thing.
Waiter!
The more you give, the more I want. What am I gonna do? How should I feel when everything is you? What kind of love is this that you're giving me? Is it in your kiss or just because you're sweet? Girl, all I know is every time you're here, I feel a change, something moving. I scream your name, look what you got to do with, darling. I can't get enough of your love, baby. Girl, I don't know why I can't get enough of your love, baby. Oh, no, baby. Girl, if I could only make you see and make you understand. Girl, your love for me is all I need and more than I can stand. Oh, well, babe, how can I explain all the things I feel? You've given me so much, girl, you're so unreal. Still, I keep loving you